and saw how completely unfair this process was, we object publicly and loudly as we can on behalf of Michael Brown Jr.'s family that this process is broken.
That again, Benjamin Crump, the attorney representing Michael Brown's family, speaking out today at a news conference, obviously reflecting on the decision that the grand jury did. No indictments last night. Now he's just one of many voices across the country who condemned the prosecutor's handling of the case. And you can't help but notice, and this segment we're going to look at how race and the justice system and race and policing, how depending on the color of your skin, you look at this two different ways here as it relates to those perceptions. I want you to take a look at these numbers. This was a recent Huffington Post YouGov poll. This was taken before the decision came down last night. It shows that nearly two-thirds of blacks and only 22% of whites believe that Officer Wilson should be punished. Think about that disparity. Then you get to this number. 31% of whites compared to 74% of blacks believe that the officer's use of deadly force is part of a broader pattern. Now, for many, this case hits very close to home, and it draws chilling similarities to, and I know, Nick, you don't like the example of Trayvon Martin, but how George Zimmerman, who obviously wasn't an officer, but still got away as a neighborhood watch volunteer by shooting and killing Martin, a young teen, unarmed, going back to his apartment that night. He avoided prison time. We all know how that case played out. And there is certainly many others. You go back to, obviously, Rodney King. But then you have Marissa Alexander, a black woman. She wasn't as fortunate when you compare it to the Trayvon Martin case. She fired a single shot in the air inside of her home to scare her abusive husband. No one was hurt. However, she's looking at 60 years in prison after trying to cite the Stand Your Ground law. And she has accepted a plea bargain, pleading guilty to three charges of aggravated assault with a weapon. Then the aforementioned Rodney King case. Jury, we know, 10 whites, one Hispanic, and one Filipino acquitted four police officers who were charged with using excessive force that obviously was captured on video. And we all know how they played out. Closer to home, Sean Bell case. Bell shot and killed by plainclothes police officers on his wedding day in Queens back in 2006. He and two of his friends were shot a total of 50 times. All the officers all found not guilty. And as I said, there's going to be two more high profile cases, one in Staten Island and one in Brooklyn, that will be coming up later in the next few months, at least we should put it that way. Okay, and before I bring in the calls, let's take a look at first race and the law. Okay, then we'll get into policing, but in the law. Both of you were convinced last night there'd be no indictment. I wasn't sure. I tried to apply logic that the grand jury would want to kick it to the trial jury so they wouldn't have to deal with it, and they had some lesser included charges that they could have had an easy way out. They chose not to go there. We've seen a lot of cases where you're surprised, or at least I'm surprised there's not an indictment, but both of you aren't. Do you believe that the whole system is racially skewed? Why do you believe that blacks don't get as fair a shot as whites do when it comes to the court and the judicial process?
I'll just say it, Professor. You know I'm a straight shooter. Prosecutors are in bed with police departments. They work with them every day. It's as simple as that. No local prosecutor is going to stand up to their own police department, Richard. It's as simple as that. The grand jury didn't do something wrong in this case. It was the weak case that the prosecutor presented. He didn't want an indictment. I know some of us don't like this. He didn't want an indictment from day one. Ask any black person in America, do they believe this prosecutor wanted an indictment? And you will get the same answer every time you ask the question.
Is it deeper than that, than people feel, if they're of color, that when they get into the system, basically it's too late? They don't have a shot?
It's much deeper than that, and I'm not sure if that's how they feel. Andrew said that we'll see this happening again and again and again. Yes, we will see this happen again and again, but not for the reasons why you think. I don't think the issue is the law. I don't think it's those issues. You have individuals who, as Dominic said, will favor one over another, which is really ridiculous. You and I are not of the same race as far as ethnicity, but we are the same human race. We have the same characteristics. One nose, two eyes, a heart, lungs, etc. So we have different color of our skin and hair, but we're still part of the same issue here. What I believe is happening is we need to go back to why law enforcement, when they encounter African-American men, in a stairwell will shoot first. What is this fear? That why is there a heightened sense? Why is it on alert so quickly? And why is it now enforcing the law instead of protecting and serving?
Well, that's a perfect segue, Nick. And let me bring you in on that, which is, yes.
If that perspective, you will respond differently if you have to protect me or enforce the law on me in that aspect.
In the tougher neighborhoods where it's predominantly white police force, predominantly African-American community, let's strip it away here. Is there a feeling among law enforcement, because we've heard it from the community, that it's an us and them when they go on patrol?
Well, that's wrongful, but I mean, you also
But is it also true?
I'm not going to say it's true, but you have to also include in what does the community think of the
police.
Oh,
I'm putting them in there, right? Too. I'm saying it goes both ways.
I think what we have here is if we could just cut away the issue of race at the issue at hand. If we do not view this as an African-American victim and a white police officer, and we took this as a case study and applied the facts as we know them and the facts that were presented to the grand jury, I think it would be a conclusion.
I hear you, but I'm just saying this, Nick, and I'm sorry to interrupt, but you guys both, everybody here remembers the Sean Bell case, okay? If it was three guys, white guys, that night going to the car, I don't believe the cops went out that night to shoot anybody, please. The two guys in the guy and his girlfriend in the stairwell, if they look like me, you know, and someone else in this building, we got to at least be honest that there's a different perspective. The numbers bear it out that if the guy's a white guy or a black guy in the same situation, we all believe, let's kumbaya, colorblind here, but it's part of the equation, isn't it?
Of course it is, and prejudice is still in existence. I mean, we've come a long way it's just unacceptable that you know, we talk about our forefathers, that they would imprison people, enslave them. To me, this is beyond comprehension. And then we had the era from post-Civil War up until the landmark cases of the 50s and 60s. Is racism still out there? Yes, but remember this, the police department is not the cure for the ills of society.
Nope.
The police department must enforce the laws fairly and equally. And an officer must separate himself from any prejudice there is. But remember, if there is prejudice, and you heard this from the President of the United States, who should be a role model to African Americans, if there is prejudice, it's systemic within the culture of the people. And that's what has to be, as the Reverend said, that has to be addressed.
But it's also, it seems to be endemic throughout the entire process. I mean, look at arrest rates or incarceration rates or, you know, I did a series on marijuana arrests in New York City, overwhelmingly black and Hispanic, and we see this up and down with stop and frisk. It seems like there is a different application of the law from police, but also through the judicial system.
You can't fault the police for enforcing the law. You have to go to society itself. Why are people not given the advantage to go to education? Why are people living in public housing and not having the opportunity to own their own housing? That's where the issue is. It's not in policing. It's a national issue. It has to deal with the morals, norms, and social economic conditions at hand.
But I'm saying something more basic, where it cuts both ways. Certain communities, if they cooperate with police in an investigation, what are they called? They're called a snitch, right? And the idea that young African-American men or women would join the police force to have greater representation. They were saying that would be the biggest impact. They want to change things in Ferguson, have greater representation, be reflective of the population of Ferguson. It would change too. But you speak to your neighborhood. How much are police looked at if, you know, as, you know, oh, great, the cops are here versus here's 5-0?
Well, I think Southeastern Queens is, Ferguson does not represent New York City nor the nation. It represented, I go back to the McDuffie riots in Dade County in 1980. I was in that. I am on the community board of the 103rd Precinct. We've had a series of wonderful commanding officers. And we, in our community meetings, you have African Americans predominantly, whether it be West Indian, African, they're and conservative by nature, concerned about safety for their kids, property, quality of life. So there is a great relationship with the 103rd Precinct And to the point that, that it's a model precinct where they have introduced POP, partnering on police, the cameras are there, these kinds of things. So I see that happening throughout the city of New York and across the nation. But it doesn't address the issue of communities. If you don't see me and I see you and my perspective leads me and blinds me, then we have these explosions of violence. We saw it recently in a stairwell. And I'm not in this officer's position. I don't know the individual, but we can assume that you're going in a dark stairwell with a flashlight. The assumption is I must protect myself. So now I'm no longer protecting and serving, I'm protecting myself.
Does it make a difference in your neighborhood that the police department seems to better reflect the composition of the neighborhood than certainly we've seen in Ferguson?
I've heard that before, and
it goes back to racism, where only people of the same color and the same background could police. That's outrageous.
And
no.
I don't buy into that because clergy, mm-hmm. with the priest scandal, everybody is a professional at what they do, and they're held to a higher standard. Nick said that the police officers have to hold on to their training, and your training, you adopt a different culture when you join the NYPD or police department.
I want to bring in a viewer into the conversation. I know the phone lines are jammed. Let's go to Rudolph in Long Island. Rudolph, thank you for holding. What was your reaction for the events last night in Missouri?
Well, upsetting. You know, I was in shock. I knew it was going to happen already, but it's upsetting. Real, very upsetting. You know, it just seems like the cops don't care nothing about black people at all. And it shows, seems like the government's crooked. Everybody. It seems like they're all crooked. You know, they speak all this justice stuff, but they're not giving any justice at all for any black people being killed at all.
And Rudolph, thank you. And you know, from my end, Andrew, I thought, If they thought this thing through, forget about how they handled last night, which was a fiasco, right? If they appointed an independent prosecutor, right? Not that it might have even, maybe would have had the same decision at the end of the day. But the perceptions of this thing going into it, it just didn't feel right. Whether Dom's right that the relationships between the prosecutor's office and the police department, that they got to work together, you know, after this decision comes down, et cetera, and not just in Missouri, but across the country. It just seems if they had started from that place, at least, maybe we would have had a different reaction last night.
Well, I mean, our caller said his takeaway was that he didn't think that police cared about black folks at all, and it seems like the entire system was crooked. I disagree with that sentiment. I'm sure you would too, Nick, but I can understand where it comes from. And certainly from some of the decisions that were made by the police and by the prosecutors in Ferguson, it's not an outlandish view to have after
seeing all these
results.
How about you take cops out of this? Trayvon Martin. If it was my kid that was going back to my apartment complex that night and he didn't look like Trayvon, there is overwhelming sentiment, forget about just in the black community, I think of most saying, if that idiot shot my kid, you know, for the crime of getting Skittles in a soda to go back to my apartment, you know where he'd be the next day. He'd be in prison. He wouldn't be walking around here celebrated or at least doing some cockamamie stuff and stand your ground. There's a perception that certainly got some sentiment of fact in it that if you look a certain way, you're going to get treated a different way in the system, not only in the eyes of the law and law enforcement, but just overall. And I'm not trying to do some societal thing. The cops have to be responsible about it. But does the system treat people differently based on the color?
I root for a team. I don't root for the color of the players of the team. And in the case of Zimmerman, I think it's a look, we're not satisfied with it. I wasn't satisfied with it. But you know what? The people of Florida, they developed the stand your ground.
I know that, but
stature.
If it was our kid, there's an application of law differently depending on who the victim is, it seems.
And again, you know, no, there are a lot of cases where a verdict comes back, which the verdict is the real truth, and we don't like it. But you know what? What are we going to do? Are we going to have the ability to change
Well, you know what? I think the perfect segue is, what What about the policing of this? Because that's at the crux of this. When we come back, I'll let Nick have a chance to respond to some of the questions about the policing and how the processes work or don't work. We'll get to more of your phone calls as well. Stay with us.